Let's join singing together now on the last verse. Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Thank you. You can be seated, please. Pastor?
Amen. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse number 19. Deuteronomy 30, verse number 19. I want to preach this morning on a choice that matters. A choice that matters. That's what I'll be talking about. Father, this morning we thank Thee so much for the Word of God. We know that without it we would never have come to know Thee. Because of it, not only have we come to know Thee, but Thou hast wrought a marvelous work in our hearts, in our lives, conforming us to Thy very image and making us what we are, and Lord, helping us to ever look unto Thee. I pray if there be one person that has never been converted, they've never been saved, they've never been redeemed, they don't know what it is to become or to have become a new creature, Lord, today wouldst Thou speak to their hearts and open our minds to this great truth. Help us and help me as we communicate it. Help us to enter into it. Make it effectual. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse number 19, the Bible says, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. So it's something that's very important. Choose life. We have set before us life and death. And each of us will make a choice in this life as to where we are going to spend eternity. We will either spend eternity with God, rejoicing, or we will spend eternity separated from God in a devil's hell. Now, I want us, first of all, to look and think about the concept of salvation. Might be that somebody doesn't understand this thing of salvation. Let me try to paint a little picture here. I want you to note the difference between what I'm going to talk about, having it and not having it. It's self-explanatory. First of all, if I was thirsty, I would need water. So if a man is thirsty and he doesn't have water, brother, he'll have a fire burning in his throat. And if he doesn't get water at some point, he'll perish for the lack of it. And that pictures for me the equality or the necessity of salvation, just like that. Without water, you will perish. The same is true concerning salvation. And then secondly, I want us to note, if I was hungry, I would need food. You will starve to death if you do not eat. These bodies require food. And if you don't have food, then it will become the great object of your life to seek food. You will do what you can to find food in order to satisfy a need without which you will perish. Salvation is the very same thing. And then I want you to note, thirdly, that if I was tired, I would need rest. A man can labor and work and exhaust himself to death, literally. And there have been people that have done that. The body requires rest. It is essential at some point that we take our rest, lest we should perish because of the lack of it. You see, we think about the turmoil that men sometimes go through and the unrest that they have and the weariness of all of that. Oh, do we not need rest? Do we not need peace? And how much more do we need that peace and that rest that comes from God? And then if I was lost, I would need salvation. But you know, this one people don't see. They can understand thirst and hunger, and they can understand being tired and in need of rest. But if we start with this point, many folk don't get this one. It just flies right over their head. But it is the same essential need as the others. If I do not find salvation in this world, then I will perish. Salvation is as important as satisfying thirst, hunger, and rest. It's just as important. Secondly, let's try to understand the need for salvation. Many of you, it's not trying to understand it. You do understand it. You're there. God has met your needs. But a man, if he's going to see his need, number one, he has to know he has a need. Amen. He has to understand that just like that thirst in his soul, he has a need of God to quench that, you see. And so the need for salvation. First of all, I'd like to say that spiritual darkness is a part of our inheritance. We were not born spiritual. We were not born Christian. We were born with a natural mind. We look at things the way the world looks at things. If we're going to be saved, we have to be born again. We have to be redeemed. We have to receive what the Lord Jesus Christ has for us. But we notice in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And of course, when you think about death, you think about darkness. And that is the state of a man before salvation. His mind is alienated from God. He lives in spiritual darkness. He does not know the Lord. Romans chapter 3 and verse number 11 says, there is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God. And why is that? Because a man loves darkness rather than light. This is the way he's born. This is the way it is with him. There has to be a time in his life where the light shines upon him and he sees his need of salvation, and God will expose that to him. Secondly, we are unable to change that in ourselves. I cannot change the darkness in me. There is no good in man. The heart is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things. I have nothing within that I can change that state inside of me. I'm talking about apart from the help of anyone else. There's no way that a man can change himself. There's no power in the flesh that he can be exercised outside of faith that can turn him to God, enlighten him, and redeem him. He doesn't have in himself what he needs. There's a vehicle that can fetch this for him, and that's faith. Faith, amen, in the Lord Jesus Christ. Faith that he loved me and died for me, and believing in him will save me. But it's not in himself. There's darkness in a man, you see. even when a man is saved. Paul's testimony was this: when I would do good, evil is present with me. Talking about even a saved man. So that darkness we have with us, when you got saved, you didn't lose that old man. That old man is there, and if you don't walk in the Spirit, as we heard praying this morning, if you don't walk in fellowship with God, you will fulfill the lust of the flesh and of the mind, and you will be a carnal person if you're saved. And that's possible for any of us. Am I right? Yes, sir. So the darkness, we're unable to change that. And then I want you to note, thirdly, there is nothing in our physical birth that is spiritual. Nothing in our physical birth that is spiritual. Adam's sin transmitted to all his kin a sinful nature, a depraved nature. This is what I received when I was born. An inheritance from my father. My father was a sinner, and thus I am what he was, a sinner. That was his gift to me. And that's what he received from his father, and that's what he received all the way back to Adam. That's the inheritance that we have. That's what we're born with. We do not naturally incline toward God. We incline to the flesh. We incline to the self and our own pleasures, our own delights. These are the things that we live for. We don't naturally incline toward God. If God moves upon you and works that work and makes you God conscious, well, that's a tremendous thing. And it happens because of his word. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word of God is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To the Jew first and also to the Greek, for there is no difference. And so there is power in the word. But apart from that, just naturally speaking, we're not born with a desire to know God. And that readily expresses itself in our life. So we do not seek him, and we do not understand spiritual things. God has to teach us. God has to unveil, to reveal, to make us to know about himself and about his word. He has to help us to see it, because we can't see it because of the deceitfulness of sin. Fourthly, we were born, and I've been saying this all along, we were born sinners. Sinners sin. That's what they do. That's why we sin, because we are a sinner. It's not my sin. I'm not a sinner because I've sinned. I sin because I'm a sinner. That's right. I was born that way. That's the old man. And sin does what? It kills and destroys. And so if I'm going to have life, if I'm going to live, then I have to have something that kills the sin. I can't kill it. When Christ comes in me, he then tells me to mortify the deeds of the flesh, to put them to death. But I can't work that until that's been worked in me. Amen. He has to work that in us. And so we're born sinners. Sin is against our well-being. Why? Because it is against God. It is the opposite of what God is. God is holy. God is only holy and always holy and never will be anything but holy. And sin is ruinous and evil and wicked. And sin will rot and destroy. And people are in hell because of unbelief. And it was their sin that captivated them and kept them away from God. Thirdly, Adam's choice of disobedience. New point here. Adam's choice of disobedience resulted in our sinful condition. So now what I want to look at, we have a need. We saw that, just like thirst. But if I'm thirsty, well, I need something to drink, or I'm going to perish. If I'm hungry, I got to have something, or I'm going to perish. If I'm so tired and fatigued that I can't conduct myself, unless I find a place to rest, I'm going to perish. And now
I learn that I'm born a sinner. I'm born that way. Now, how did that happen? How did it get that way? It is because of the disobedience of one man that sin has come upon us, according to the scriptures. Adam had the perfect environment. Adam was created. And he didn't have a whole bunch of commandments that he had to keep. He didn't know anything about all those commandments and the need for those commandments. God had simply given him one command when he made him and put him in the garden. And that was not to eat the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That was the one command that he had. Well, let's look at the scriptures. Adam was given this commandment. Would not only affect himself, but it would also affect his posterity in the future. Everyone that would be born in the future would be affected by his choice. Your choice matters. And so, read with me in Genesis chapter 2. We're going to be there for a good bit. Genesis chapter number 2 and verse number 15. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 15, the Bible says, "And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it." Adam was in a place that we call paradise. And it's somewhat of a hint to what heaven is going to be like. I think we're going to be occupied in heaven, amen? I don't think we're going up there to lay on flowery beds and do nothing. There's going to be some work to be done up there. You can just mark it down. God likes that. And so that's where Adam was, is he was in the garden to keep it, to dress it. Verse 16, "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat." And so here's man in the midst of the garden, and all of these trees, God has planted everything that he would need. There lacks nothing. The tree that Eve would look upon and the statements that she would make about the tree that Satan lied to her about was not any better than the other trees that were there. The fruit was just as luscious. There were no worms to eat it. There was no blight upon any of that fruit. That fruit was in the condition before the curse came upon the earth. It was each and every bit of it beautiful and good. Amen. So what am I trying to say? That the need was met, right? I mean, they didn't need what God said was for himself. He had more than sufficiently supplied for their need. So we're looking at a lot of things. Sin has a lot of stuff in it, doesn't it? Greed, huh? Has a lot of stuff in it. "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." Now, that tree in the midst of the garden was like the tithe. And God's saying, I'm giving you 90%, but this is mine in the midst. Honor it. Don't eat this fruit. It's mine. You don't have to give anything. All you have to do is leave it alone. That's for me. But we continue to read. And the Lord said, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Now, God gave Adam a wife. This command came to him before she was born. Okay? Before she was formed. He told Adam. Why? Because Adam would be responsible. Follows out in Ephesians chapter number 5. He's the head. And all of this would take place as a result of the fall here. But yea, even in the beginning, God made man responsible. And so, who told Eve what she knew about that tree? She misquoted what she had to say. And so, it's my assumption that Adam told her. Had to. God told him. That was an important thing, not to eat that fruit. Huh? And so, he told her. I believe he told her not to touch it. Lord didn't say that. He said, don't eat it. But Adam was trying to be safe about this thing. If you don't touch it, no problem, right? But before we get there, God gave Adam a wife. created her out of a rib in his side in order that he might have a companion. He had just witnessed all these animals that God had created, and he named them all, and there was not found one for himself. So God made man a companion. Genesis 2, verse number 18. And the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him." Verse 21. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. Verse 22. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, and the man and his wife, and were not ashamed." They were not ashamed. There was no sin. They didn't perceive anything wrong in what God had done here. Now, Eve is on the scene. Adam communes with her, speaks with her. And so we find that their state before the fall is a state of innocence. They are not righteous because they have not done righteousness, nor are they wicked because they have not done wickedness. They are in a state of probation. They are both innocent at this point before God. And they had not committed sin. And this was a paradise. Amen. Can you imagine what it must have been like? No curse upon it, no curse on them. I mean, everything was good. God fellowshiped with them in the cool of the day. That fellowship, it couldn't have been improved on. It was the best man has ever known in this world. Now, Lucifer at some point has fallen before this. He was named Lucifer. We understand him as the adversary, the devil, our foe. He had fallen. And the jealousy now in his own heart that God is in fellowship with a creature that he created out of the dust. Man is living in paradise on this earth. And so Lucifer sets out to trump man, to cause him to fall, to bring him down. But he doesn't go directly to Adam to do this. He chooses the woman to do this through. And we read about that in Genesis chapter 3 and verse number 1. Satan's attack was primarily against the Word of God. He questioned the Word of God to Eve. Genesis 3, 1, now the serpent was more subtle. Oh, he was so tricky. You know, he wasn't crawling on his belly at this time. He was flashy, beautiful, and spectacular. I mean, he was the most subtle of all the creatures. I mean, there was something to be beheld in the serpent. You know, the devil always paints the best picture before he infects with the poison, does he not? Yeah. And the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, "Yea, hath God said," there's the question, "hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" She's heard from who? She's heard from Adam. Adam's told her. God told Adam, and Adam's told her. And so now she said, "Yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said unto the serpent, "We may eat of the fruits of the trees of the garden." And so she responded rather good here in the first, huh? Instead of playing on the negative, it was the positive. Yeah, God's given us everything that we stand in need of. This is all the plenty, and that will stand against her. But she goes on, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. So she understood, don't eat it, or if you do, you're going to die. Right? She understood that. Now, the devil has got the whole scene set. He's got in mind where he needs to go. He's got her response. He's got what she said, God said. And so now the devil will attack this. And the serpent said in verse number 4 unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, contradicting what God said. God said, if you eat it, you'll die. And the serpent said, you're not going to die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. He's holding back on you. You're not experiencing everything that life has to offer. There's something more. They knew nothing about evil. What do they know about evil? The devil can make evil sound good. And that's exactly what he did here. Don't be surprised if somehow or another, through the trickery of Satan, he has made something to look good and you followed it and taken the bait only to experience the damnation of it. He is perfected in this art. He has worked this ever since the very beginning. And whatever it takes to damn a soul, that's exactly where he strikes. His venom is on purpose. So he questions God. God said, you'll die. No, you won't die. God's a liar is what he's saying. You say, that's what he's saying. God, you're a liar. And he knows. God's just holding back from you. If you eat that fruit, your eyes will be open. You'll behold. And so secondly, he convinced her to eat the forbidden fruit as something to be desired, even though it was against the will of God. And she knew it. She just quoted him. She just told him what she was told by Adam. And God told Adam this. There was no reason to doubt God. There was no reason to go contrary to God. Every need that they had was being met in abundance. More than enough they had. And yet we see this power of sin. She now is gripped in verse number 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, why? Eve, look at this other tree. Look over here, Eve. Are they not just as good? Do they not taste just as good? But Satan had marked this fruit because God had put it there for himself. And so she looked at this tree and saw that it was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes. And a tree to be desired to make one wise. She took the fruit thereof and did eat. She ate that fruit. Often you have two parts that are put together in a verse of scripture. And the other part, they run together and it makes you think that that all happened right there simultaneously. Not to say that it couldn't happen all together. But I think what happened is Adam wasn't present with her. And the devil had tricked her and deceived her. And she looked at this fruit and she ate it. And then she took it to her husband. And he saw her condition. Not desirous of losing her companionship. So Satan knew how to get to him. Satan knew what to do. And it wasn't a foolproof given that it would happen. This would be his first dealing with man, but it was successful. It did work. Can you imagine how much more conniving he is now? How much more he understands about this art than he did? He's not omniscient. He doesn't know everything like God knows. He's a creature that has to learn. We can only imagine right now the deceit and the wickedness and the treachery that's involved in deceiving people and tricking them to believe a lie and not the truth. Satan's attack, thirdly, upon the man was through his wife, and Adam had a choice to make, and his choice would affect you and me, the world. It would affect us all. And I tell you, it was a choice. For her, it was deception. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 14 says this, "And Adam was not deceived." He knew. He remembered. He didn't forget what God had said. It wasn't ignorance. He understood full well what he was doing, and he did it. That's tragic, isn't it? He did it. So the transgression has passed upon us through Adam. That's where our inheritance has come from. Now, Adam's choice was to rebel against God. That's what his choice was. He made a choice to go against God's word. Satan had lied to her and tricked her, but he knew the truth and made a choice to line up with the devil in this. What would have happened had Adam gone to the Lord and said, "The woman that thou hast given me"? I mean, he makes this statement, but he's on the wrong side of the tracks when he makes it. He's trying to shift the blame and put it on her. But what if he had gone to the Lord before the fall? What if he had come to the Lord and said, "Lord, the woman that thou hast given to me, I love her, but she has been deceived. She has been beguiled. She's been tricked. And what am I to do?" Boy, I tell you, God only knows what could have came out of that. I don't know. You know, I shouldn't have even suggested it because I don't have an answer for it. I don't know what God would have done. The fact is, it didn't happen. But it could have happened. And then God would have showed us the results of it. Amen? He'd have worked something out on behalf of it. But it didn't happen. It resulted, their rebellion resulted in spiritual darkness that we talked about earlier in the passage. Adam and Eve were changed as a result of their disobedience. Their whole manner and way of life changed because of this sin that they had sinned. It all changed for them. Their eyes were open. The first thing, chapter 3 and verse number 11 says, is they saw themselves naked. God came calling on them. And because they were unclothed, they hid themselves. And not only because they were unclothed, we also notice that fear was on them in verse number 9. So two strikes. Number one, they saw themselves naked. And can you just imagine, here comes Adam and Eve out before God, and they've got these fig leaves on them. Lord, what's going on here? Well, we were naked. Well, who told you were naked? How did this happen? Did you eat the fruit? Oh, yeah, I ate the fruit. The woman gave it to me, and I ate it. And she says, well, the devil deceived me, and I ate it. Shifting. And so what happens is they are fallen from the state that they were in. They're fallen. Not only have they fallen within morally because they've rebelled and sinned against God, but now God is going to drive them out of this paradise. John chapter 3 and verse number 3 says, if a man's not saved, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. And the next verse says he cannot see, it may be reversed, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So if a man is not saved, he will never know what it is to live in God's heaven. Just like here, they were driven out of paradise, you see. And there's not been another paradise made on earth. The paradises, quote unquote, that men have on this earth are sin palaces, you know, that people have in places that they go to. There are no paradises here. The earth has a curse upon it. The thorn in the briar is before us. We earn our keep by the sweat of our brow because of sin. I'm not going into all the various aspects of all of that. Fourthly, well, let me say in verse number 19, the worst thing that happened is God was good for his word. In the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. The process of death now had started. Man would return back to the dust of the earth. Now, fourthly, God had a plan to provide salvation for fallen man. It wasn't something that happened as an after effect. God foreknew our choices. He understood from eternity past that given opportunity and all that was before us in our best environment, we would rebel against Him. And He made a way wherein we might return to Him, that we might be brought back to God, that our sins might be pardoned, that we might be rescued from the perishing. Aren't you glad for that?
Amen.
Amen. He promised to provide redemption and restoration for the sinner. And He gave it to them right there in the Garden of Eden, right there in the midst of where they were, in that very setting of their offense as He spoke to them. I'm sure they may not have understood what it was really saying, but it was found in chapter 3 and verse number 15. "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." It's clearly understood in the light of Scriptures. As we move through the Scriptures, we can really understand what He was talking about when He referred to thy seed. Thy seed, He's talking about the serpent's seed. This rebellion that they now were involved in, their children would be born in darkness. Their children would be the fruit of this rebellion against God. We're born sinners. Thy seed. Adam is the federal head of the human race, and he's fallen, and we are fallen. And then he goes on to talk about her seed. And I read before I talk about her seed, let me read that verse again in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12. "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, by one man, by thy seed, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." Now, what about her seed? Isaiah 7:14 throws some light on that. Isaiah 7:14, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive her seed." This is an impossibility unless God intervenes to accomplish this. And he did. He promised it in Genesis 3:15. We read in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, it came to pass. This verse here in Isaiah 7:14 says, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel," being interpreted, "God with us." So the Lord sent a Redeemer into the world to deliver us. The first Adam had failed us. The second Adam would redeem us. I read about this second Adam in Hebrews chapter 7 and verse number 22. "By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament," talking about Jesus, "and they truly were many priests because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death." And he's talking about these offerings in the Old Testament that were brought and sacrificed. And the priest, he could only live but for so long. But here was a priest made after the order of Melchizedek. Here was a priest with an endless life. And we're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. He gave his life upon the altar, amen. His blood was shed for us. And that blood was shed after he had lived 33 and a half years in this life. And not one thing in all of this world was able to have a claim upon him for wickedness. His thoughts never were wrong. That's amazing, huh? His words were never wrong. His actions never accused him as something that was wrong. He was the perfect man. And thus we read in Hebrews in verse number 26. "For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens." And no one less than Jesus Christ could redeem us from our sins. He alone could do this for us. The first Adam made a bad choice. Esau lost his birthright.
He made a bad choice. The second Adam, Jesus Christ, came to die for our sin and to offer us eternal freedom, eternal life. He came to give to us something we could have never gained by ourselves. God could not accept us because we were filthy. God could not accept our offering. Oh, we may be repentant, but all that sin was there. Oh, he had to cleanse us. And he could only do that through a pure sacrifice. And that was Jesus Christ. Amen. Romans 6:23 tells us the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Savior. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth upon the tree. He's cursed for us. Let me very quickly put some words in your hearing. See, I have set before thee this day life and good, and death and evil. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you death, blessing, and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. I've left out that word live in that verse. Not only, he presented life and death. Proverbs 11 and 19, as righteousness tendeth to life, so he that pursueth evil pursueth it to his own death. As Proverbs 12:28, in the way of righteousness is life. In the pathway thereof there is no death. The law of the wise is a fountain of life to depart from the snares of death. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life to depart from the snares of death. The law of the Lord, the fear of the Lord. And unto the people thou shalt say, thus saith the Lord, behold, I set before you the way of life and the way of death. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Adam and Eve made the wrong choice. They made the wrong choice. What choice are you or have you made? Have you decided for Christ? Have you received the gift of life? Or do you abide in darkness? And the scriptures would hasten us to receive this most wonderful and abundant gift. Amen. It's beautiful. It's the right choice. It's the good choice. It's the best choice. It's the only choice if you want to live. There is no other Savior. No other way. Jesus is the way. We're going to sing page 292. Let's stand with our heads bowed. Father, this morning, we bring our hearts before thee, and we've seen in the scriptures a choice that was not the right choice. That didn't have to be, they didn't have to eat that fruit, but they chose to eat. Lord, I pray if there's one person in our midst that has never been saved,
God, would you speak to their hearts this morning? Lord, would you help them to see that they need salvation? There is thirst. There is hunger. There is no rest that can only be quenched spiritually in thee. Lord, show us our need. Move in the service this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.